All right, so I'm going to open our Iowa City City Council work session for Tuesday, September the 17th, 2019. We have three topics we want to get through before we turn to our agenda items, so let's see how well we do on that. The first topic is a joint meeting with the Telecommunications Commission, and I understand that two of the commissioners cannot be here tonight, so I'd like to welcome Adam Stockman and Andrew Austin to our joint meeting, and also thanks Ty Coleman, staff member, or not staff member, staff person assigned to the commission for joining us. So I also want to thank the commission for its very thoughtful and thought-provoking short memo, if you will, providing recommendations to us and enabling us to discuss possible futures and responsibilities for the commission. So I wonder if, Adam, perhaps you or the two of you together could briefly recap the essence of that recommendation that you provided to us.
Yeah, sure thing. I feel that we're kind of at a point with the Telecommunications Commission where we need to decide one of a couple things. What's the purpose of this commission moving forward? With the expiration of Mediacom's franchise agreement with the city, the charge for this commission is kind of less clear, and we haven't had a whole lot to do. So one of the things that we looked at in this recommendation, which actually kind of predated my membership on the commission and Andrew's as well, is just to look at, do we just disband the committee or the commission and kind of go on our ways? Or do we essentially look at whether or not municipal broadband is something that Iowa City wants to investigate? And really our proposal is not necessarily the full-blown investigation into it. It's kind of looking into whether we should really invest resources into kind of fully going after municipal broadband. So
I'd just like to build on that slightly. Taking a look at the proposal here to form the Municipal Broadband Advisory Board, there's sort of clear guidelines as to what we would actually be doing or what this board would actually be doing. And I know one of the concerns was the use of city resources looking at something that has already been investigated in the past. So some of these guidelines will help to limit the use of city resources. It's almost investigating whether we should devote city resources to investigating municipal broadband as a possibility.
Great, thanks. It's a helpful summary. You know, we did have a brief conversation about this in our last work session, right? About Rockne, you weren't here and weren't able to participate in that discussion, if I remember correctly. You know, time passes.
Okay.
But the discussion was pretty brief, and the essence of it was we wanted to have a conversation with you so that we could figure out what would really be the best thing to do. So I think we've all read them. I'll call it a memo. We've all read it, and now we've got a brief recap of it. I wonder if any of you board council members would like to begin by asking any questions or expressing any thoughts about what direction we ought to be moving. Rockne?
Yeah. So this was actually sort of a topic that has interested me for quite a while. I'm sure many of the residents in the community as well. The municipal broadband and broadband service in general is something that we as councilors get a lot of complaints about, you know, in terms of the private service, without commenting on any particular provider. It is something that from time to time people say, gosh, you guys really should have that, or you should at least explore it. Of course, usually they're not really aware of what the price tag of a full-blown out system would look like. They can cost, I know Dubuque has evaluated, for example, and it can cost tens of millions of dollars. So it is a very significant investment. That said, there are communities throughout the state of Iowa that have investigated this. So I think when you had talked about investigating the prospect of investigating, I don't think that's redundant in the sense that an actual formal study, this would likely have to be a decision on the part of the next council, would cost substantial resources. I know at one point I think Jeff had maybe said, you know, $60,000, something along those lines, very, very significant amount of resources. But in terms of this advisory capacity, in terms of preliminary information, to the extent that there are other cities that are willing to share what they have learned in terms of implementing. It's my understanding Cedar Falls does have an active municipal broadband, is my understanding, and I think there are other municipalities that do as well. That would be relatively low cost in terms of just time, and it would seem to fit consistently with what your concern is that sort of one task is sort of becoming unnecessary at this point, given the expiration of the recent so essentially sort of mandate of what you guys were doing. So I would really like to explore that. And if you investigate those cities, talk to them that have implemented, maybe talk to cities like the city of Dubuque and learn from what some of their preliminary studies have indicated, then the future council can indicate, hey, we either want to move forward in a more formal way and actually get some details. And once we get those details, we can decide which direction we'd want to go. And by the way, I don't think that doing the study commits us to go any direction. It may be that after doing that study that they say, hey, we should continue on the path that we are already on. But I think it's incredibly important to make sure that we have the top-notch municipal broadband or broadband service that we can get. And also, secondly, that we're really focused on the equity piece of it, because I think that is another part of it in terms of access. Broadband is becoming a service, much like water, electricity. It's sort of a baseline utility as opposed to a luxury. So at least from my two cents, I would like, to the extent there's support, the rest of council to offer the task force an opportunity to investigate what other cities have done, and to come back and make a recommendation into the future as to whether perhaps a more formal study would be worthwhile, so that we can get a clearer picture of which direction the city should go.
What do the rest of you think?
Well, when I look back at what we talked about, I don't know, 2 or 3 years ago, I can't remember exactly when it was, it was clear from a lot of the literature that we saw at that point that basically the cities who had done this already had fiber in the ground because they already had their own power system, and that was what tended to make it even remotely affordable for them. Mm-hmm. And for communities who did not already have fiber in the ground based on having their own power plant, it literally was probably over $100 million to implement. We now are in the process of getting a second provider in the community, so we have more competition, which hopefully will improve the quality and the outreach within the community. And so, to me, the likelihood of this even fitting on our radar because of the extreme dollars is probably very, 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 very unlikely. And so it doesn't really make sense to me at this point to have people even spending their time on it.
How about the rest of you?
I just had a question on the two-page memo. It just mentioned forming the board, but further on in discussion with your commission itself, you threw out a number of possibly 10 people. Where did you come up with that number?
Out of the air.
Out of the air. Okay.
Yeah. No, it was that was based on a which commission or which?
I want to say the Climate Action Committee. Proposal, something like that?
It was based on an already existing committee, just as a starter.
Mm-hmm. I did want to briefly address the issue of the potential very large cost of this project. Very recently, maybe within the last year or two, there have been a lot of developments in certain technologies, such as wireless mesh networks, which could potentially reduce the cost of a project like this. 10,000-fold if you're talking about, digging up to put in fiber as opposed to simply using wireless technology. So, of course, that's something that would have to be investigated, which is, one of the reasons we might want to consider an advisory board, just because of that improvement in technology.
Yeah, I'm at this point, I think, because there are so many questions and possibilities that are associated with this, I'm inclined to support the kind of preliminary analysis phase that you're considering. I mean, just in my brief today, looking at on the web on this matter. It sounds like there are quite a few municipal broadbands just in the state of Iowa. Indianola has one as well. So it certainly suggests to me an investigation. I think I would add one concern I might have in terms of the board members would make sure that labor is represented. I didn't see that. I think that would be an important piece of this. And looking forward, also the question of equity, because that seems to be a major issue in terms of one reason I think cities are considering it is making sure that there is equal access and subsidies that would be available to low-income households. But I think to me there's just enough there to warrant a preliminary investigation.
So I'd like to ask you all a question. Maybe Ty can weigh in on this too. I'm wondering who really would do the preliminary study. Are we talking about four people in the Telecommunications Commission, or I know there's reference in your memo about appointing a new board or an advisory board of some kind to actually do that work? And I'm wondering what kind of study are you imagining would be done by a small number of people who probably have other things to do in their lives?
No, it's a valid point. I think that back to Mr. Cole's comments about, you know, other cities have already done this, and I think reaching out to people that helped get that off the ground or people that are currently involved with those other municipal broadbands, just calls to them just to kind of pick their brains a little bit. I think it can start as simple as that, and that's something I think that the commission as it stands right now could definitely do, is just to kind of reach out to those people and try and just get some of those very basic questions answered of, you know, ballpark costs, you know, what are some of the newer technologies that that could dramatically reduce those costs, but really just to start that investigation, and if it builds from there to a point where it does warrant being a, you know, a 10-person special commission that's formed or something like that, or special board that's formed, then so be it. But if that preliminary investigation reveals that it's just that it isn't feasible, then we're not really out anything. We're out, you know, four people's time that are looking for something to do right now. So,
okay, I want to present a little bit of my own thinking about this without coming to some firm conclusion yet. And what I'm going to say is consistent with what I said in our last meeting. This is not high on my agenda, and it's not part of our strategic plan to commit any staff resources or council mental energy and political capital and all that kind of stuff to extending broadband services through municipal means. So I don't think we should take it up this year as the council in terms of what the council does, and I don't think we ought to dedicate staff time to that either. I can be persuaded that it would be worthwhile to have the commission conduct a relatively, you know, very preliminary study that is done by the commissioners with their own resources and a modest amount of help from Ty, but, you know, I mean, he's got stuff to do also. And if that's what we're talking about, I might well be able to support the idea, but I won't go beyond that. So I'm wondering what the rest of you think.
Well, we're talking about, well, I appreciate you all coming and making the suggestion, so thanks for being here today. The advisory board, I think, you know, could be a possible good idea just to get some preliminary information. You know, the mayor does make great points about staff dedication time and the ability for us to pull it off financially. But, you know, this is no longer a luxury. It's something that people, you know, rely on every day. And so I am more inclined to definitely support some type of a preliminary information on this. I'm not exactly sure if, you know, to go at an extreme as the advisory board, because potentially we can get enough information from the commissioners that can give us some type of an indication if we need to go to the next step, which would be an advisory board to then research if we will bring in staff resources to go further. So I think as a, I appreciate you all presenting it, because it is something that within our community people do struggle with financially, and even the services itself. But I don't want to be critical, because the services, many appreciate, many love. And so it is not about any criticizing services that are existing by any means. It really is just looking at if the city could provide it for our locals.
For me, I really think this, first, thank you, of course, for coming out here. But I really think this is really a good idea. And but when it comes to the cost and everything, but just to talk about the service itself, it will be really good, because I know a lot of people, he doesn't want to criticize the company that who exists him, but I will, because I have a lot of people who come to me and saying that they give us this price, and after 1 year, the price jumped like $30 or $40 more, which is people in this community, low income, cannot provide internet that for like $90 a month or $100. I think maybe if the city done it, will be cheaper for the community. But of course, we need to know a lot of information. And maybe, as Rockney said, we need to contact another city and see like how things being done, and if we as financially can accommodate this, or a staff or the time, as they said. But this is, will be great if it happened.
Can I follow up with a couple other questions? I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Just a couple questions for clarification. Andrew, you mentioned this innovative wireless technology. Could you give me the language again?
Sure. It's a wireless mesh technology. It's being used by a few private companies in larger cities. I know of one in New York City. And then a couple sort of collective groups formed in different communities. It's very early on emerging, but it has the potential to very much drastically reduce the cost of implementing something like
this. Great, thanks. And I'm also wondering about the fact that there is a second provider that is extending service, broadband service, throughout the community. How does that influence your thinking?
Well, I think competition is great within the internet service business, especially because many companies are notorious for providing bad service until the minute a competitor comes in. This would open up the potential to add competition where there's still only one provider in Iowa City. Specifically, some of the technologies that we might investigate, such as wireless mesh, would allow individuals who live in apartment buildings or different situations where they don't have any control over their internet service. You know, if they could put an antenna in their window, then now they do have a second provider, and they do have that accessibility to competition, which would really just put the pressure on the private companies to deliver a much better quality of service, lower price, better equity.
I guess, Jim, you keep saying two provider. Essentially, Link is not considered with them, or what? You know, there is three provider or two?
Well, I don't know. Ty, what's the answer to that?
Yeah, I think you could consider CenturyLink a broadband provider.
Yeah.
They have some limitations in certain areas, whereas MediaCom is more likely to have the same offering across the town.
Yeah, MediaCom is covered everywhere, but CenturyLink and even IMON is now just for business and the southeast side of the city, but it's not everywhere. Yeah.
Yeah, great.
Just curious about your comment about like people in apartment buildings and stuff. Will that, do you know at this point that wireless mesh technology, is that something that like an individual would be able to purchase to tap in where there is not, where they're not hardwired in?
Sure. So from the amount of research that I've done, which is admittedly small, the way that the technology works on a very basic level, you have antennas that would be set up by the city, and then consumers could purchase a sort of receiver kit, and they just set that up where there's a line of sight to one of the larger antennas, and they would be able to self-install it, set it up all on their own. And then, you know, there's no need for wiring through buildings that people may not own or to dig up anything.
So would the private companies be able to set up those antennas so people could connect to the private companies with the wire mesh?
There are private companies that provide it, not in Iowa City, but it is a very new technology. It's starting to emerge in some of the larger metropolitan areas.
So as soon as one offers it, the others will too, probably.
Pauline, did you want to say something?
I was just going to say, from the discussion, it sounds as though these folks on this commission have already started steps towards looking into this. They have, they're like two steps ahead of us on a lot of the knowledge on this, so I see that as a plus. And since it would potentially be short-term, it sounds like, just investigating this, and they've proposed it to be a period of 1 year, I think it's appropriate to form them, or let them continue as an advisory board, because I kind of see it as an extension of the cable franchise. It's just a different venue. So I would be in favor of it.
Great. Anybody else want to say anything? Do you all have any questions for us?
Do not.
Are you looking at just expanding the role of the Telecommunications Commission then?
What I'm hearing is support for the commission conducting a preliminary study to determine whether a more full-blown study would be worthwhile. That's what I'm hearing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So where's our city attorney staff? I think this is compatible with the existing task of the Telecommunications Commission. I don't know. I can't see Eleanor.
There's Eleanor. There. There she comes.
Sorry, Eleanor. There's so many people out there, I couldn't see you.
I mean, it's pretty focused on cable TV, but you could probably stretch it enough for that.
All right. That's what I was hoping to hear.
Well, and just one final comment. What do we have to lose here? I think it's just information and the very valuable time of the commission. So I don't mean to, minimize that, but you do have a little change in mission a little bit. So I'm comfortable that there's no taxpayer dollars now that are going to be expended. We'll get that learned investigation. And at that stage, a future council will be able to say, hey, we want to commit to a more formalized study.
Mm-hmm. I'm fine if it's just the commission doing it for now, trying to gather more information to bring back to us. I don't think we need to go through the steps of setting up a 10-person advisory board right now.
I don't either. Do you all want to give us a timetable, an approximate timetable? Like,
to come back.
We could ask you to return to us in 3 months, 6 months?
Just under promise and over deliver, let's say 6 months.
All right, preliminarily, we'll say you'll return to us in 6 months with your findings. You know that you're short one person on the commission. We have an appointment to make tonight. Given what is a clear decision here tonight, we'll appoint a person, so you'll have five people on the commission. At least that's certainly what I expect to have happen tonight. Okay, anybody else want to say anything?
I just, again, along with others, thank you for proposing this. It seems to be a nice initial step to consider some options.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, good deal.
All right.
Thanks so much for coming. Thanks for your efforts on part of the commission.
All right. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for you coming, Ty.
Thank you.
Can move on to our next topic, which is consideration of a Climate Action Commission. And as we all know, staff presented us with a draft resolution for consideration. It seems to me the key questions before us are three. First, how many members should be on the commission? Second, what shall its composition be? And third, what its purview should be. The staff has offered answers to these and a few other questions. So my thinking is we can just move through them one by one. I don't hear any objection, so we'll begin with the first one. So about the number of members on the commission. So the staff doesn't really recommend, but just lays out there 7 as a possible number. I personally think 7 is too few, but the 13 we had on the Climate Action Steering Committee is too many. So too few, too many. Somewhere in between is a nice number, and ought to be an odd number probably. I'm inclined toward 9, but I'd be curious to know what y'all think. 11, there's a possibility.
I like the number 9.
I do too.
Well, that's because both of you lived through the Beatles. You know, number 9, the song number 9.
Oh.
Come on.
I just think like
as a baseball player.
When I said 11, I really think about diversity on the diversity and knowledgeable pool. Sometimes you will find somebody who like could be provide the diversity, but he's not really knowledgeable about the issues. That's why I guess adding those people will help so they can educate the community, you know, that they don't know anything about this. Mm-hmm. That's why I say 11.
Okay, what do the rest of you think?
Prior to Maz stayed in 11 immediately, 11 came to my mind. So I would just stick with 11 for my response.
I think 11 is good with, it said that one would be it would actually be 9 and then the 2, the Mid-American and the U of I, because from the list of interested people for partnership, it's very lengthy. And as Ma said, because as I mentioned before, I would like to see a healthcare professional on there too with their background in healthcare and the effects of climate control on health. So I think 9.
Well, just so everybody knows, the challenge with regard to diversity of all kinds is pretty big. So we're not going to be able to get everybody on this committee that we think would be appropriate. So we just need to have that in the back of our minds and as we proceed. Rockne, Susan,
I think to that point, I think that's why I think 11 does make sense. I always have concerns with, there is sort of that Goldilocks number we're looking for. If it becomes too big, I think it gets a little unwieldy, but if it's too small, it doesn't really have the technical expertise as well as the diversity, I think, that we want to have on it. So I think to your point, Jim, it is true. It's always going to be a challenge, but this gives us just a little extra cushion to ensure that we do have that, because I think we need to have that balance with the equity as well as the expertise, because our goal is to get that reduction and get that technical advice. So I'm at 11.
Anyone else? Okay, I'm hearing 11.
So 9 at large, and are you comfortable with the 2 appointments and how we have that structured?
Yeah, I don't know that the others would be at large. That's really a question about the composition. But 2, I mean, if y'all agree, that one would be a Mid-American representative and another would be a University of Iowa representative?
Yes.
Okay.
And so we're clear on the university. We're talking someone that the university administration would appoint, not just somebody affiliated that the council would appoint.
Yes. Right.
That's what
correct.
I understand, too.
Correct. Correct.
And then would the city have any overview on how the university appoints this person to the commission? No. Okay. Got it. Thanks.
All right.
I believe a student was listed under the list of the possible others.
Yeah, and in the steering committee, a student, there was a student representative.
Right. Yeah, but I would just like to make sure that's repeated again this time around. Yeah,
right. Maybe it will and maybe it won't because we've got a lot of diversity to try to cover.
I guess a student could be one of the 9.
So the steering committee that had 13 members included 5 members from the general public, an architect, an undergraduate from the University of Iowa, and representatives from the university administration, Kirkwood, the Home Builders Association, the Chamber of Commerce, Procter & Gamble, and Mid-American. So if the commission has 11, so we need, if the commission has 11 members, 2 of whom would be from Mid-Am and the U of I, that leaves 9. So I would suggest that, that 6 be drawn from the general public, just as a preliminary proposal.
Can I just make one clarification? So the earlier committee was the resolution actually specified where the people were going to come from, and then staff worked to find those people. So it's not, they weren't, the actual people were not appointed by council. In this case, we're going to have applications.
Yeah, that's not quite true, because the public members were people who voluntarily submitted applications. There were like 45 applications. But the others, like from Kirkwood and Procter & Gamble and so on,
staff,
companies or whatever, appointed their own people.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you envision that same thing happening here?
For the public members? That's what I would strongly recommend.
But for the others? Because that's not how the resolution is.
Yeah, for however many others there are.
Make that decision.
Yeah, that's what I was imagining.
That makes sense to me.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
So six and then the five of the technical positions, is that right?
In addition to the, what?
Yeah.
Well, no, let's see if I did it. There'd be three representatives from entities, mm-hmm. not the general public. All right, so one way to proceed possibly would be to have a representative from either Kirkwood or the school district. So one representative from an educational institution. And then maybe one from either the chamber or the Home Builders Association. And one from, I don't know. My notes are based on the number nine, so I don't know.
My suggestion would be that you really focus on what you think, what type of background you really need on the commission. You know, if you do an either or, that's really tough for us to. Do we go to Kirkwood? Do we go to the school district? Both would probably be interested in participating. We can target when open applications come up. We can target and we can encourage people with certain professions or backgrounds to apply. But you know, from staff, when we drafted this, we felt it was absolutely essential, given our greenhouse gas emission study, that Mid-Am and the university be there. As we looked at the others, they kind of said, yeah, it'd be great if we had this, this, and this, but we could envision any number of collections of folks over the years that may have those backgrounds. So I would say, is there anybody other than the university and Mid-Am that absolutely has to be represented that you want? For example, maybe a home builder, but
could we maybe give then for these slots sort of staff discretion? So six, would it be possible to do six that come up to council and that we would choose, and then three would come where staff would make the recommendation or selection? Is that what you're getting at, Jeff? Or no?
I'm comfortable wrong? With council making all the appointments. Okay. I think if you just want designated seats like we've talked about for the UI and Mid-Am, just be very specific on what you want.
Okay.
It gets troubling with an either or type of situation, at least from my standpoint.
So what staff is recommending in here is that those two positions are necessary, and so they will be appointed by their entities. And then we will seek applicants, you know, telling as we seek applications, these are important attributes that we're looking for, et cetera, along with diversity. And then council would appoint the remainder.
It's kind of like, you know, we do this with HCDC. And you may have remembered a staff memo last time we had appointments to HCDC where we say, you know, it would be great to have somebody that has a banking background or affordable housing background. We don't require that, and if you don't get those applications, you can move forward with another appointment. But when staff is promoting a vacancy, we can target those backgrounds.
I mean, you may very well be faced with the decision, is it more important to have this expertise, or is it more important to have this diversity? And you can make those judgments as you appoint those other nine.
Yeah, I think Mazur was exactly right. We need to have a mix of people who have knowledge that's relevant, but also experience, backgrounds and experiences that reflect the diversity of our community. So somehow we need to blend those two things together. I'm not wedded to my suggestion to have only six public members, but I think it is important to get what I just described.
I think Pauline mentioned like healthcare and you know, having a healthcare provider on this commission. I wonder if we don't get into categories of what we're looking for, and as we get the applications in, we are considering who's already on there and their expertise, and try to figure out who might be good, because we're sitting here trying to figure out what expertise might be good, and there could be something that we're not thinking about. And then if we have that earmark, then naturally we wouldn't be able to go with that individual. And so my thought is to kind of not have it earmarked. Yes, the university and Mid-Am definitely have them earmarked, but the others just kind of, you know, receive the applicants and then make decisions from there as council.
I would agree, Bruce. I think, plus when you start getting the staggered terms, you know, as different people go off and you can see what they've accomplished and how the dynamics work and what their suggestions might be, you know, I think it could change over time what you really want that makeup to be. So I think if we're going to go with the 11 and have the two set with the university and Mid-American and just have the other nine at large, I think as we're making those appointments, like you said, we've got ideas in the back of our mind in terms of various expertise we think is important, diversity, representation of the community that is important, and we kind of look at all those pieces as we do the appointment.
So I noticed that there are two members of our Climate Action Advisory Board in the room, John and Matt. Matt, as your chair or whatever, right, of the board, so could you come up for a second? I'm just wondering if you could tell us how many, if you will, active members there currently are on the advisory board, because according to what the staff's recommended to us, they will automatically go on to this new commission. Unless, of course, they don't want to be, and that'd be different.
Yeah. Right now, I think there are seven that are active members. I think in our recommendations that we had given to staff, we were looking at nine as a board. I think 11 is a great number, too. But I think we also listed a list of backgrounds or expertise that would be good to have on there, expanding a little bit on what was originally on the original steering committee, knowing that, you know, we had sort of missing voices as part of that development. And so that was one of the reasons we listed some additional ones. But I agree with the approach that, you know, leaving that open to be able to kind of pick as you need it as you change over time, right? We want this to kind of be a lasting document over the period of the many years that we're looking at for this effort. And so that gives you the flexibility to be able to do that without having to be tied down too much.
Okay. Yeah.
Great, thanks. That's helpful, Matt. So we haven't gotten to this point yet, but I just referred to it, and that is that the current members of the advisory board would automatically go on this commission unless any one of them chooses not to. So that'd be seven. There'd be two from the organizations we've already mentioned. So that's nine. So we'd really only be seeking two new appointees initially. And then we do the staggered term thing, assuming everybody agrees to that in a minute.
How diversity is the seven now?
I think that's actually hard to determine because we don't all know each other's personal backgrounds and the expertise that you're bringing to that. So where did they grow up? What are their personal experiences? We know the background professionally that we're bringing the expertise side of it to the table. So in that way, I think I would also say that we've been at this for about 2 years now. I think having some additional new people, fresh faces to supplement those that have already been on there is great. I would also say that of the seven that we have, at least one would fulfill the requirement that you need for one of those two. You know, that's up to those organizations to appoint. Mm-hmm. But sure. In that seven, one represents one of those organizations, Mid-American. Mm-hmm. And so there's the six more right now that would be representing other kinds of backgrounds.
Sure. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, I think I'm hearing support for basically having a sort of an open-ended invitation for people to apply for the vacant positions, and there'll be some language in the invitation to apply about seeking people with appropriate background, knowledge, and experience, and then also representing the diverse components of the community.
Sure.
Okay, so the third point in the staff's recommendation to us is what we've sort of just been talking about, that any active member of the Climate Advisory Board who is interested in serving on the commission would be appointed as an initial member, even if not gender balanced. So, Eleanor, the implication is that this commission would be gender balanced?
Well, your policy says that you'll seek gender balance on all.
Okay.
Regardless of whether it's required by the state, this would be specific to this commission.
Okay. So are you folks agreeable with that recommendation?
Sure. Yes.
Okay.
Given particularly that it only, am I correct in this, Eleanor, that this only refers to the initial appointments, correct? As we, as people's terms expire and we reappoint, would this still be under our gender balance?
No.
I mean, I'm assuming it would be, because the only, unless I missed something, the only place I'm seeing the not gender, potentially not gender balanced, is under that number three, in terms of the active members of the Climate Advisory Board interested would be appointed as initial members.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The resolution draft earlier, before you hit the numbered components, cites cites the appointment of these members initially without regard to gender balance.
Okay.
So that currently, as it stands, would be not completely imbalanced in either direction. I think it's, you know, maybe 5-2, something like that, currently.
I mean, I think that's, I think it's important starting out to have a core group of people who've been involved and really have an understanding of where we're at after this 2 years. And then as we move forward, moving it more towards that gender balance if it isn't at the beginning.
Yeah, I'd agree.
Okay, let's move on to the next recommendation. So the fourth was city residency is preferred, but members are not required to be Iowa City residents as long as they are residents of Johnson County and meet the requirements set forth in paragraph two, whatever that is. So go ahead, Maz.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think members from the general public should be Iowa City residents, but I guess that doesn't fit with this, what we, our discussion now. So I think they ought to be Iowa City residents. That's true for almost every other commission.
But it seems for the MediaCom, for the Mid-American Energy and University of Iowa,
I would agree.
We don't
there.
Have to say
right.
that.
That wouldn't
right.
be the case.
Yeah, maybe for the rest of the commission, yes.
Do we have any other commissions where non-Iowa City residents serve?
CPRB, I believe, can have a non-resident.
Yeah, and with the Board of Appeals or something like that.
No,
isn't there one other commission or board?
I don't think so. The CPRB is the only one that's coming to mind. I think, I don't know what the residency is of the current members, so we'd have to look at that issue.
I think it's mixed.
John or Matt, do either of you know the answer to that?
I can't recall everyone on the commission, but there is at least one. So.
Who is not a resident or is a resident?
Correct.
Not
a resident.
Okay. Well, what do you all prefer to do?
I think the reason, perhaps it's obvious, that residency was expanded here is because of the need or the desire, perhaps, to have certain expertise on the commission that you might not find in Iowa City.
Would we be able to grandfather this one person in then if they were previously a member and were saying
you
previous
could
commission
write
members?
The resolution that
then that would be acceptable.
Well, yes, limited number, one number or so for the outside Iowa City, but Johnson County.
I think I can expand on Eleanor's comment as well. it is kind of a representation of whatever skills and expertise this person could bring to us. If they live in Johnson County but run a business or own a business that is conducted primarily in Iowa City and they're concerned about whatever it is that happens here, I think it's addressing or potentially addressing those kinds of scenarios. If there's an emeritus professor, if there's a whatever the case may be that could fall into that category, I think that was the thought.
Given the kind of expertise that we're looking for probably the bulk of the people on here, I'm comfortable to have it written that city residency is preferred. Typically, I would be exactly where you are, Jim, that if it's going to be a city commission, it should be a city resident. But we're asking here for a number of these positions to have some pretty specific expertise. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that as a council now and going forward can be looked at, you know, that balance of residents versus non-residents, business in the community. Maybe they don't live in the community, but they work in the community. They have a key set of knowledge that would be really beneficial. I think the council could look at that. So my initial reaction was the same as yours. I had it marked in my text here. Mm-hmm. But given that it's written that it's preferred, but we could look beyond that if we felt we needed to, I'm comfortable with that.
Well, especially, too, that I think eventually, even though this would be maybe way off into the future, who knows, maybe at some point this could morph into a regional commission. We don't know. That's beyond the charter of what we're doing now. But obviously, greenhouse gas reduction is something that does cross city lines, and it is something that we are going to need regional buy-in. So I think to the extent that we have that expertise beyond our borders, normally, I would be opposed to that. I think we do need to have the Iowa City buy-in, but it really is. It's a regional problem. So I think this can at least give us, and to your point, Susan, the expertise. We don't want to close people off that want to serve. So I like the preferred concept, subject to the qualifications.
I do like that wording also, preferred. I'm more comfortable with it. I agree, Jim. It's nice to have it say Iowa City required, but since it says preferred, not required, then I'm okay with that.
I would ditto everything everyone said. So.
Okay, I think you all got clear guidance on that. The next item has to do with the terms. So member terms shall be 3 years with a two-term limit. And the initial term shall be staggered in length with three members appointed
this will have to be adjusted because.
Some odd number.
We'll mess with being or four and three.
Yeah. Yeah. So you can figure that out. I think, would you all agree that we should stagger the initial appointments?
Yes. Definitely.
Three-year terms, you agree with that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. No more than two consecutive terms?
Yes.
All right. Another part of that recommendation from the staff is that the representatives from Mid-American and the university will govern their own appointments and not be subject to term limits.
I would agree.
I agree, yeah.
Okay, got that.
It has to be that way, really.
All right, the next part is the commission may form working groups and or subcommittees on specific topics and issues to achieve substantive progress on action areas of the Climate Action and Adaptation Plan.
Yes.
Yes, yes. Nope. Any disagreement with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Seventh, the Climate Action shall basically do the following. Advise the City Council on climate issues. Research and analyze and promote climate actions with particular attention to equity. Educate and engage with the public on climate action and the city's climate and sustainability goals. Assist city staff, city council, and members of the community with implementing approved initiatives that support the city's climate and sustainability goals, including the Climate Action and Adaptation Plan and any related or updated plan thereafter. And then I'm not sure what's going on with the last recommendation. There seems to be a typo of some kind because there are like two D's.
E.
So the last part, recommend to council updates to the action plan, that's not supposed to be there, right?
Yeah, it would be E.
It's separate.
It should be E?
Correct.
Okay, so E, recommend to City Council updates to the Climate Action and Adaptation Plan. Okay, do those sound like
yes.
A good set of tasks for
yes.
our admirable commissioners?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Okay, very good. And the last is that the committee or the commission shall adopt bylaws which it deems necessary and advisable for the conduct of the business of the commission. All right, I'm seeing
yep.
a lot of nodding heads.
And just as a reminder, those go to the Rules Committee of Council and then come to the Council for approval.
Well, right, and we do have a Rules Committee, don't we? I don't
yeah.
remember who's on it. But a couple of you are the
That's
Rules
Bruce.
Committee.
Yes.
we never
would
met.
I be correct that staff would kind of give them a draft set of yeah. bylaws to start with? Okay, thank you.
Okay.
All right, very good.
I just want to ask, what the kind of staff support would be available for the commission?
Well, right now, it would be through either the city manager's office or through Brenda Nations. In November, we need to deliver our 100-day report to you, and that will outline our plan for a new staff position that would probably be thrown in that mix, too, and support the commission. So I'm still working the details out on that, but I don't think that'll be an issue.
Okay, great.
All right, does any other council member want to mention anything else on this topic?
Jim, I think one of the commissioners.
John, come on up.
Appreciate very much the discussion tonight. One thing I'd like to volunteer that we have discussed it at great length, and I represent this, I'm an old white guy. And I had some questions to my fellow committee members about whether I should hang in there, which I would prefer to do, or make room for more diversity. I was very concerned about that and didn't want to leave. But what I want to stress is we all agree that we really need to work on diversity, and the working groups that we're going to be putting together will reflect that. We're very, very conscious of the fact equity and diversity are really, really important. And I just want everyone to understand that we're thinking in those terms. Okay. That's key. We also had a lot of discussions about whether we wanted a commission or wanted to remain flexible, if you will, in the roles that we were in. And I think we all agree that we kind of like this accountability partner philosophy. And I'm not here to suggest how we operate, but we want to be held accountable. We like the credibility that we'll have with the public being commissioners rather than volunteers. And we're ready to dig in and work really hard on this. And I just want that to be communicated. Accountability, hold us accountable. I won't mention that we'll hold you accountable. That's a given. So, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Just remember, you're still a volunteer commissioner.
Yes,
there's no pay.
Oh, I thought I was getting paid. Thank you.
I thought I paid big bucks. Thanks, John. So
right.
On the first point that John mentioned, I'd like to note that the recommendations that came from the staff also said that the commission would have the ability to draw upon other people who are not members of the commission to help with these working groups and subcommittees, or not subcommittees, but working groups that would be helping the commission. So they can draw from all sorts of people mm-hmm. from outside. Okay, bravo. All right, I think we can move on to our third item, which is a presentation on bike lanes for South Dodge and South Governor. And I was right, it's Kent Ralston. Hi, Kent.
Good evening. Good evening, Kent Ralston, Transportation Planner. Thank you for allowing me the time to discuss the Dodge Street and Governor Street bike lanes with you this evening. I wanted to first just quick provide some background and information on the project, just so we're all aware of what's occurring, and then move from there. As you all know, the Bike Master Plan was adopted back in 2017 and identifies both Dodge and Governor Streets between Burlington and Bowery as candidates for dedicated bike lanes. Staff did hold a neighborhood meeting on August 7th to discuss the merits of the project. The meeting was very well attended. I estimate maybe 75 to 80 participants, so many so that we filled this room and actually had to use the Dale Helen conference room as well. The crux of the project is that approximately 40 on-street parking spaces are contemplated to be removed on each corridor, depending on how the project goes. We actually split into two groups at our August 7th meeting. One group was residents, because we had so many we had to break up anyway. We had one group in here that was for essentially the residents of Dodge and Governor, and then we had another group for folks that were just interested in bike lanes but maybe didn't reside on one of those two corridors. I will say, just before we get started, that there wasn't a lot of opposition to the removal of parking on Dodge Street. There were a few, certainly, but when we discussed removing parking on Governor Street, there was a vast majority of participants that did not want to remove parking. So just keep that in mind as we move forward.
But can I interrupt you and just ask the question, how many of those buildings on South Dodge between Burlington and Bowery are rental and primarily student housing, where they may very well have been out of town in August and or just not been aware of the meetings?
Right. Good question. I don't know the answer, but I do know that when we reverted Governor Street south of Burlington back to two-way years ago, we had done some research, and of all of those units, I think if it wasn't 100% rental, it was close. There might have been a few owner-occupieds then, and I assume it's the same now. I will say that we did mail letters to the property owners as well as the residents, so if the residents weren't here, I would assume that the property owners would speak for them if they needed the off-street parking, because essentially if they don't have the parking, they might not be able to over-occupy a unit, they might not be able to make as much money on their unit. So that was sort of my logic behind that. The reason for doing it when we did was just keep the project moving.
Sure, no, I get that. Yeah. I get that. Thank you.
Good question, though.
Kent, following up on that, if I understood correctly, you said that on South Dodge as well as South Gunner, there are roughly 40 parking spaces on street?
On each corridor, correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So do you have any sense about what the vacancy rate turns out to be throughout the day?
We don't know we don't know for sure because they're not marked spaces. So we estimate that there's about 40 spaces that would be removed, right? There's no actual meters or parking stalls that are delineated. So we estimate 40 stalls on each street. We did a morning, noon, and night observation on a couple different days, and I would say it's mostly full most of the time. So I'm going to say 80 to 90% occupied at all times. And I think you'll see that pretty much any time you travel those corridors. Little less maybe so for Governor, but certainly Dodge is pretty much bumper to bumper.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Certainly. Something else to keep in mind that came up at the public meeting quite a bit and has come up throughout the conversation is that on-street parking has to be maintained for Bethel AME Church, and that came through a special exception that was granted when they did the addition to their building a number of years ago. So it's something like 12 or 13 on-street spaces have to be maintained for them. So that's something that we just all need to keep in mind as we go through the project. And then lastly, there was a memo in your info packet from last week, outlining again some of this background, and then we provided six potential options that were discussed either at the public meeting and then certainly by staff subsequent to the public meeting. So just to orient yourselves a little bit with the project location, this map comes directly out of the Bike Master Plan. It's a little bit hard to read, but what I want to point out is that the area, if I can find my cursor here, in red is the project location area. You're all familiar with, I'm sure, but just to kind of point out a few other things in context, this would be Dodge Street coming in and ending, terminating at Kirkwood, and then of course this is Governor Street here. Burlington on this map would run right north of the project location area. There's a number of related projects that I want to bring to your attention to that sort of they're directly related to this project. One is that there are existing bike lanes on Governor Street now, buffered bike lanes north of Burlington that I'm sure you've all seen. There are also planned buffered bike lanes for Dodge, essentially from Prairie du Chien at the north end of town, again, all the way to Burlington Street to match what we did on Governor. We're hopeful that that will happen yet this fall, but it sort of depends on how this conversation goes. There's also a 4-to-3 lane conversion, so this would be similar to what we've done now in Mormon Trek, Clinton, and First Avenue in Iowa City. There's a 4-to-3 lane conversion on this section here of Dodge Street that we'd also like to complete this fall, if possible, and again, depends on how the conversation goes. That would include bike lanes as well. So
that's from Bowery down to Kirkwood?
Correct.
Okay.
So if we were to add a bike lane on Dodge Street, we would essentially have a continuous bike lane all the way from North Dodge all the way to the terminus of Dodge Street at Kirkwood.
So from a bicycling point of view, Kent, you're saying that these segments are crucial for north-south connection for bicycles?
They are. And they're a little bit different. The southbound connection is a little bit different because Governor, of course, terminates north of the tracks. But we can kind of get into that a little bit later, too. I've got some information to share. The last thing I want to share that's a sort of related project is, I think regardless of if we added a bike lane to the section of Dodge, we would like to revert that section of Dodge back to two-way traffic, just like we did on Governor Street years ago. It was intended to be done years ago when we actually reverted Governor Street back, but there was a little bit of worry with the First Avenue grade separation project that we actually needed that southbound movement, so it sort of just sat on the back burner. But we would like to do that regardless, and that actually would not really affect, it really has no effect on the bike project, so to speak. It's just something we would also like to clean up at the same time as the 4-to-3 lane conversion, at the same time as the bike lanes north of Burlington. So all these interconnected projects. In case you haven't seen them in a while, I just wanted to show you what these corridors actually look like. Governor Street's obviously on the left, Dodge Street's on the right. They are both 31 feet wide, and the reason why we sort of the crux of the project is removing parking, which was in the bike master plan, is because in 31 feet wide, you can't have you can't accommodate a parking lane, two through travel lanes, and a bike lane. There just isn't enough pavement width between the curbs. As far as options for discussion, these were in your memo in the info packet, but I wanted to quickly discuss each of them tonight as well. And again, each of these were discussed at the public meetings and subsequently by staff. The first is to eliminate on-street parking and implement buffered bike lanes on each corridor, which is represented in the bike master plan. The second option would be to only eliminate parking on Dodge Street, but then add pavement markings and signage on Governor Street. And I'll touch base on that a little bit later. The third is to reduce each corridor to one travel lane and implement buffered bike lanes, which could retain parking. So this is a little bit different. This isn't something we have in Iowa City. But if you only had one travel lane in each direction, then you could retain the parking and have a bike lane. Number four is widen each corridor and implement bike lanes and retain parking. So if we widen the corridors from 31 feet, we could, of course, accommodate then a parking lane and bike lanes as well as the travel lanes. Number five is something we've not done in Iowa City but is done elsewhere in the country, is providing a shared parking / bike lane on both corridors. So this would be where you have a bike lane during a certain part of the day, and then you allow parking in that same space during the evenings and on weekends, that sort of thing. And then the sixth option is sort of the no-build solution, which is essentially to retain current configurations and not eliminate the parking. So quickly, I just wanted to run through each one of these. Number one is to eliminate the on-street parking and implement buffered bike lanes on each corridor. I say here that it fulfills the bike master plan to the full extent, which it would. It obviously provides continuity in existing and planned north-south facilities, which we sort of already discussed. And the image here on the right is actually the buffered bike lane that was implemented this summer on Governor Street, north of Burlington. So that would be essentially what we would be looking at implementing on both Dodge and Governor Streets. This would require the removal of approximately 40 parking stalls in each corridor, like we already discussed. It would, I think, create hardships for neighborhood residents with limited off-street parking availability. I think that's certain, probably more so on Governor, but certainly on Dodge as well. And I can touch base on that in a minute. And it would require accommodations for the church, as we've already discussed. The second is to eliminate on-street parking and implement the buffered bike lane on Dodge and just use pavement markings and signage on Governor. I say here that it would fulfill a portion of the goals of the bike master plan because it's obviously sort of a hybrid approach. It would allow a continuous southbound bike lane pretty much from Prairie du Chien all the way to Kirkwood with those related projects that we already talked about. It would then, of course, provide shared lane arrow markings and bikeway signage on Governor. That would essentially provide at least some help to bicyclists as they move northbound across Burlington and get in the buffered bike lanes. Again, this would require removal of approximately 40 on-street spaces on Dodge, but retain the parking on Governor. I think instead of saying could create hardships, I think it would create hardships for Dodge Street residents. But again, I think it would impact those folks on Dodge less than it would Governor. And I've got some slides I'd like to show you here in a minute. And then I say that Dodge is arguably the more important corridor. It has twice the daily traffic volumes as does Governor Street at this point in time. And it also provides access south of the tracks, which Governor doesn't. So you've got Summit on one side that provides access south of the tracks, and you've got Dodge, but Governor, of course, terminates it just south of Bowery. The third option is to reduce each corridor to one travel lane and implement buffered bike lanes while retaining parking. The image here, I believe, is from, I think it's from Burlington, Vermont. Whether or not we would use bollards is to be debated, but that's essentially what it would look like. You'd have a travel lane, one through travel lane parking, and then of course you'd have the bike lane as well. I say that it would fulfill the goals of the bike master plan because it would. It provides the continuity for north-south on-street facilities. It maintains parking on each corridor, which is certainly the crux of the project. It would necessarily revert Governor back to a northbound, mm-hmm. just one single northbound through lane. So years ago, it was two northbound through lanes, and we changed that to a two-way corridor. And this would, of course, turn it back into a one-lane street because you'd have Dodge Street one lane southbound and then Governor one lane northbound. So it sort of flip-flops what we had previously done in that neighborhood.
Ken, could you comment on the impact on speed? I mean, the whole critique of the one lane is when you have two lanes one right. way. There was a real increase in speed. What does the research show with one lane?
I honestly don't know. I suspect that, I don't know, to be honest. I really don't. I don't know that this isn't used in very often, I would think, or very extensively. We could do the research on it. It probably wouldn't have a huge effect. I think it would be close to what it is today, probably, but I don't know that. And then the last thing I said was it would require further traffic engineering analysis, primarily on how to connect these at the north and south terminus. So, you know, you've got two lanes, Dodge Street coming southbound at Burlington, two lanes northbound, and then at Bowery, you've got the same issue where we'd have to work on how to exactly get the lanes to line up appropriately and that sort of thing. It's obviously not been designed yet. The fourth option is to widen each corridor and implement bike lanes while retaining parking. It would obviously fulfill the goals of the bike master plan. It provides that north-south continuity. However, it would require a capital improvements project. A real rough ballpark cost estimate that the engineering group put together is about $400,000 for that includes both corridors. But again, that's really ballpark. It's not been designed. It could be more, could be less.
I would assume there'd be a lot of trees we would lose, too. Well,
that was related to my question, is how much wider are we talking?
So that's a good question. It would be 34 feet minimum, but probably 36 feet would be what we would want if there's the room available. Yeah.
5 foot.
I think 34 would be the absolute minimum because I think you've only got 33 foot between the curbs then. We always measure back to back. Probably 36 feet would be what we would want. And I say that especially on Dodge because it's a transit route, and I'm guessing even through the new transit study that's being worked on now, I would guess that it remains a transit route. Governor is not, and probably wouldn't be again because it doesn't have that continuity north to south. So I don't know for certain, but I would say 36 is what we would shoot for, and I honestly don't know how many trees would be removed and that sort of thing yet, but it would certainly have some impact. And then the last thing, obviously, this requires further traffic engineering analysis because we haven't designed it and for all those things I just mentioned. The fifth is what I mentioned earlier. This option's not been used in Iowa City, but has been used elsewhere in the United States, is to provide a shared parking / bike lane. And we could do this on both corridors. I say it fulfills a portion of the goals of the bike master plan because it would sort of do so only for a certain period of the day. It does provide some continuity north-south. It would provide a painted dedicated area that could be used for bikes during what I would say is the busiest commuting hours, maybe between 8 and 5, and then it would allow for on-street parking in the evenings and on weekends, similar to other locations where we have parking issues in town, where we have restrictions between Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. Would obviously require some on-street accommodations for the Bethel Church. And I had mentioned we have not used this in Iowa City, but it is used elsewhere. And then last is sort of the no-build solution, where we essentially would mark both corridors with Iowa City bikeway signage and on-street pavement markings. You may have noticed we've started to use this blue sign. Actually, it'll be popping up throughout town. This is sort of the new signage we're using when we don't have space for on-street accommodations for those locations that are in the bike master plan. So these are sort of what we're calling the Iowa City bikeway, and these will typically be used with directional signage that you've seen around town, giving the distance and time to places. So this is sort of the no-build solution, like I said, but we would be able to provide some accommodation. It just leaves that gap between, especially on Dodge Street, between Burlington and Bowery. After the public meeting and after meeting with staff from Public Works Engineering and the city manager's office, we do think option two is probably our best foot forward at this time, and that's to eliminate the parking and implement the buffered bike lane on Dodge, but this then provide the pavement markings and the signage for Governor. We say that for a few reasons. Again, I think the southbound Dodge bike lane provides a lot more continuity than the Governor would, and I've got a slide to show you in a minute. We'd provide some accommodation on Governor. We would require the removal of approximately 40 on-street spaces on Dodge, which is going to create some heartburn for some folks. However, I would argue that removing parking on Dodge is, again, not as important as, or is not quite a big a deal as removing parking on Governor Street. Dodge has paved alleys with more off-street parking than does Governor Street. And these are a few slides that show sort of the difference between the two, if you're not familiar. These are the Dodge Street alleys, both looking south. So on either side of Dodge Street, there's an alley that accesses essentially all the properties. They're both paved, and there's just gobs of parking back there, primarily because they're multifamily buildings and they need a lot of parking. This is what the alleys on either side of Governor Street look like looking south. So it's almost, they're sort of a night and day difference between what the two look like. Governor Street's obviously more single family homes, whether they're owner occupied or rental, I couldn't say for sure, but parking is much more difficult. And in sections, I would say that they're gravel at best, almost dirt in some sections. There's also some vertical topography in there. So I think in the winter, it would be difficult. And that's what we heard from the public during the meeting. A few more things. I mentioned Dodge, I think, is arguably a more important travel corridor. This image is to sort of try and show what I mean by that. And when you look at actual connectivity, the red is the railroad tracks. This is Burlington Street, you can see, and this is Kirkwood. Again, you've got this continuity on Dodge Street that runs all the way to Kirkwood, and we could provide that bike lane, I think, if we removed the on-street parking, which is what we're recommending. Really, if you're coming from the east side or even the south of Kirkwood, most folks are probably going to use Summit Street. And once you get to Bowery, if you're northbound, it's sort of six of one, half a dozen of the other, whether you stay on Summit Street or whether you cut over and use Governor Street. The whole idea behind the bike master plan recommending bike lanes on both Dodge and Governor is because we've kind of got this one-way loop that we've always had. And we would just, of course, have that one southbound bike lane and then one northbound bike lane is sort of the idea. So that's where that comes from. But arguably, I think Summit probably provides better connectivity. So that's sort of the impetus for where staff's coming from with our recommendation. The ADT right now, the average daily traffic on Governor Street, I'd mentioned is twice as much. The average daily traffic on Governor is 2,400 a day, and on Dodge it's about 4,800 a day, so almost exactly twice the amount of traffic. Again, probably more important to have bike lanes where there's more traffic, where you can actually feel a little bit safer and have some protected area, where on Governor at 2,400 vehicles a day, you're going to feel a little bit safer as it stands today.
What about speeds on those respective streets? I think the two-way has been great for Governor.
It has been. We did a follow-up study after we reverted it back to two-way, so this has been a number of years ago. I think it shaved off a few mile an hour, not as much as we would have liked it to. Mm-hmm. I think it was as much to do with neighborhood feel, to be honest, and feel like you're less on a highway. Okay. But there was a slight reduction, is my recollection.
When you talk about the average daily traffic, one of the recommendations in here was to go to one lane of traffic mm-hmm. on each of the streets. So looking at just Dodge, not Governor, is going to one lane of traffic with the count of 4,800, is that a feasible, reasonable way to go?
Yeah, I think it is. I mean, we would certainly want to look into that given that direction, but I think it would be sort of mid-block. What we would need to look at is at the intersections, how to connect those with the roadway north and south, because they're going to be so much different. You would, if we move forward with the road diet south of Bowery, mm-hmm. we'd have a three-lane section. That you'd have to essentially line up with, and then north of Burlington, you've got the two. So you've got 2 to 1 to 3. So it's just a matter of how those line up. But right. I think in capacity terms, yeah, I think there's enough capacity there.
Okay,
Kent, do we
to be
know,
determined, but I think that's my inclination.
Do we know on Governor? It's you were saying 2,400 vehicles a day.
Mm-hmm, correct.
Do we know? You know, is it equally north and south split 50-50, or what's the split?
Yeah, the split when we did that study years ago after we reverted it was certainly more northbound. I think, again, because you can only continue northbound north of Burlington, and it had been that way for as long as I can remember, a northbound one way. So I think that's sort of folks' natural inclination is to do that. But I don't know the split, but I certainly was weighted more heavily northbound than southbound. And I assume it's still that way today. I'm almost certain it is.
So one potential benefit of eliminating the southbound lane, going to one way, one lane only on Governor, would be a reduction in the southbound traffic. You wouldn't have that. But we don't know what its number is.
It's true, yeah. I'm almost certain it's less than the northbound. I don't know what the exact split is. We would look into that, certainly.
Or the alley pictures on Dodge Street. I'm assuming that you're showing where the apartments are and not like the single family homes as well as the duplexes.
Right.
Because I would assume that they don't have as much parking at those sites.
Yeah, I think that's true. Primarily the single family homes have been split up in such a way now that most of them have I would say, adequate parking. I don't know that that's true, but they have more than a few spaces, most of them. And what you'll see if you drive through those alleys is that there's a lot of impromptu parking. And I think, you know, we could see a little bit more of that with a reduction in on-street parking on Dodge. But you have to remember, too, that Dodge Street's really two blocks. You know, there's no inner bisecting street, but really we're talking about two long city blocks. So really we're only talking about removing 20 spaces over the, you know, in one block, and 20 spaces in one block, essentially. Doesn't sound quite as bad when you look at it that way. But if you do drive down the alley, even for the single family homes that are left, I think they have adequate parking. It seems like they almost have more parking than they probably need, which may be over occupancy or other issues. But
well, y'all might have more questions for Kent, but for now, what I would suggest we do is focus our attention on South Governor first in terms of figuring out what to do. Because the two segments, South Governor and South Dodge, are just different. So we could focus on South Governor, see what we get to, and then, assuming we are able to come to a decision about it, turn to South Dodge. Okay?
Sure.
All right, so does anybody want to start off on South Governor?
Sure. For me on South Governor, I'm not in favor of getting rid of the parking. I think the residents along there were very, very strongly outspoken about the problems that would cause them in terms of, you know, the condition of those alleys, the, you know, coming down from on steep onto the street, the lack of parking, sometimes cases of elderly individuals and those kinds of issues. So I'm not in support of removing the parking on Governor. I'm open to whether we just do the shared markings or whether we eliminate the southbound lane and make it one lane of traffic and a dedicated bike lane. I'm really open to either one of those. I guess my strongest point is I don't think we can eliminate that parking. I think it's going to cause a real hardship to a lot of residents along there.
I agree. We've heard over and over again that parking is such a premium in the community, and especially those areas close to downtown. And 40 spaces is quite a few to be eliminating. So I would be in favor of leaving the parking on Governor.
My inclination is to agree that we should not get rid of that parking for all sorts of reasons that y'all articulated. But I think we need to have a dedicated bike lane. Sharrows are inadequate from a bicyclist point of view. They're just inadequate. So can we come up with something that accomplishes both? So
yeah, get rid of the southbound
get
lane.
Get rid of the southbound lane.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, I'm okay with that. You know, it does seem what I tend on both streets to want to give priority to is parking and the bike lane. And if we need to adjust on the travel lanes, to me that's of less, assuming, as Kent said, in terms of traffic volume, we're okay, then it seems to me we can go with closing down one of the traffic lanes and allowing dedicated parking.
I think that's definitely true with regard to Governor. I'm not sure it's true with regard to Dodge. But,
I don't recall. Go ahead, Maz.
Okay. Yeah, I'm also not in favor of, like, taking the parking away or eliminating it. You know, for me, like, option 2 and 3 is really good, providing shared lane at Pavement Market on Governor Street and also implementing a buffer bike lane. You know, when both options for me is really good. Either one.
Well, yeah, I don't remember. Did we talk about so often one lanes are paired? Did we discuss doing a one lane on South Governor and then doing a two lane on Dodge? I mean, was that one of the options there or not?
No, it would actually be, because of the same width, it would be taking each corridor down to one lane if you're retaining parking on both Dodge and Governor.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So if we want a parking lane, a bike lane, and a travel lane, it would be
one
travel lane on both, correct?
On both. Okay.
Dodge would be southbound for obvious reasons, and then north would be on Governor.
And that's number 3, right?
Correct.
Yeah, okay. Because we were just sort of breaking it down into pieces, and I didn't know whether then we'd have a separate discussion on South Dodge, so that makes sense.
One question I had on that scenario, Ken, is we haven't really talked about, well, you did show a photo from Burlington, Vermont, on what that might look like, but what about the possibility of using the parking lane between the bike lane and the travel lane so it would serve as a buffer?
Yeah, that's certainly an option. That's something we would look into. The issue you might have, and I don't know if this would happen or not, is if you have one vehicle pulls to the curb and all the other vehicles do what they would be intended to do in that case, you have no place to go as a bicyclist, because then you essentially get trapped between the mm-hmm. buffer. The buffer in that case would be the vehicles. Is that correct? Yeah. So if the buffer is the vehicles and someone doesn't do what they're supposed to do and parks at the curb, you essentially hit a dead end. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how frequent that would happen, but that would be one drawback of that solution.
Yeah, and we don't have any bike lanes like that right yeah. now, so people correct. Are not used to looking out their back right for a bicyclist.
Right. And the nice thing about the separation is you don't have any dooring issues. Now, the doors would be the passenger doors, which aren't as frequently as the driver door, but you'd still, you know, you right. do rid of the dooring issue that way. The only thing I would mention with this, too, that I didn't mention before is for deliveries. So in a situation like this, for deliveries, you're certainly going to have UPS trucks, Postal Service trucks, that sort of thing, parked in the bike lane at certain points in time. Which is no different than Clinton Street right now and some other things that we're trying to work through.
Hey, can we put those 5 options back on, Ken? So, and just quick with a question. So it's staff's sense that it's more important to have that access to the south as opposed to the north, because there are other northbound travel lanes like Summit, like even Governor as it is with the 2 lane, that it's not as important to be able to go north as opposed to south because of the connectivity issues.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
So my position is going to be is that I actually do support staff's view on 2, that we keep Governor as is, and that as to South Dodge, that we adopt essentially the buffered travel lane as far as that goes. So I'm actually recommending travel 2. And one of the things about this is that even with a lot of bike advocates have acknowledged, this is a really tough decision. I do think, though, that if we are serious about our climate change, about our community health, and about our transportation equity, we really have to make sure we're facilitating connectivity for our cycling infrastructure. It is going to cause some heartache, but I think I also want to put the shoe on the other foot. What about the heartache for the cyclists that continually don't have the access that they need either? So it is very difficult, but I would support the option too. I know you wanted to do one at a time, Jim, yeah, but I'm sort of having difficulty separating the two. I think two makes the most sense.
Can you put up the options again, please?
One thing I would be interested in is partially modifying staff's recommendation, get rid of the parking on Dodge, but on Governor Street, have that shared parking bike lane instead of the Sharrows. Because I agree with Mayor Throgmorton, Sharrows don't really mean anything. And for the signage, I think it might be of note to put in, instead of the share the road signs, to have those may use full lane signage. I've seen it in Cedar Rapids, and it's been empirically shown to be more effective. And then another thing I would like to see is that if parking is removed on any of these streets, that transit connectivity is improved, later hours for the buses, shorter headways, as a way to offer meaningful alternatives to people who don't have space for their cars anymore.
Well, there's a lot already with the shuttle that serves that area. And
one continual complaint is that Free Shuttle South stopped running at 6 p.m. And most people obviously are awake past 6 p.m.
So I think we're assuming that the public comment from the neighbors of Governor Street were just speaking about removing of parking. But I think I remember these neighbors were very influential in one of the two-way for Governor Street. And they worked really hard to get the two-way, and it worked. You know, they got it done. From some of the people that I've talked to, it actually slowed down traffic from their perspective. Of course, they didn't do a study. And so I think we're assuming, potentially, that is only parking only that the residents may have been talking about. But they fought really hard to do two ways. The other thing about Governor Street specifically is through the university program, there's been hundreds of, thousands of dollars, converting these rental properties to owner-occupied properties within that community. Mm-hmm. And so the neighborhood is more stable than, especially compared to Dodge on some level. And so it is a challenge when you think about, Governor Street going back to one lane. I think I can live with that. But I do think that the residents fought really hard to make it a two lane so that it can have more of a residential feel.
It's a big pain for the residents. I mean, the whole thing with the two lane is that you get the friction. But not only that, for the residents there, they would have to go all the way, to another block and down and then up. I mean, it is much more difficult for them. So that's why I want to keep the two lane there.
Yeah. So I know that Summit Street actually has a little, pocket of where bikes share the roadway. I'm not exactly sure where I want to land on Governor Street, but I'm almost thinking of, just mixing with the traffic on a shared street for the bikes for Governor Street. As far as Dodge, I think definitely option number three, going to one lane, travel lane, and implement a buffer bike lane and retain parking would be appropriate. That is already going one way to convert Governor back. I'm not exactly sure. So I think right now I would say for Dodge Street, option number three. And then for Governor Street, I'm going to have to say just leave it as is and there be shared streets with bike and traffic.
So I'm a longtime bicyclist. I've been biking around here for at least 30 years. And I know that bicyclists learn to use all the streets that they can ride on safely. And if that means sharing the road with drivers, they do that. but that's not particularly safe. It's much better to have a dedicated lane for bicyclists on key roads, not smaller roads that are not heavily traveled at all, but key roads. So I think we definitely need a bike lane on Dodge going south. Yes. Now I'm violating my own instructions.
Just speaking on governor.
And what about the revert to, is that beyond the scope of tonight's discussion for Dodge to revert to two-way? Is that beyond the scope? Or I think at some point Ken had talked about that, correct?
Yeah, actually, that's a good question. Unless we can't revert it back, meaning we have a southbound one way. Well, if we were to use option three and reduce Dodge Street to one lane, obviously we couldn't revert back to two-way. But if that doesn't occur, that would be staff's idea would be to change that back to a two-way corridor. And in fact, if we were to use staff's recommendation, that's what we would do, is change it back to a two-way street. So both Dodge and Governor operate as they sort of were intended to.
That's what I like, too. I think it's the best of both worlds. We get the connectivity, plus we get the honor the neighborhood on Governor. And I think the other thing, too, even though Governor is a lot busier road, it does remind me of sort of like biking on College or something like that, where it's a two-lane, but it's something that it's relatively slow speeds that you feel pretty comfortable biking there, is my thought.
And I think
I just want to ask you, when you had the meeting with the resident, what they're feeling about changing the street to one lane?
Governor or Dodge?
I mean Governor.
Governor.
Yeah.
To be honest, I don't know if I have a good sense for that, and I would worry that they would not want that. You know, it's an option that was thrown out, but with 80 or so people in the room or rooms, we weren't able to get everybody's opinion. I would hesitate to say if that's something that the neighborhood would support or not, and that's why the staff did not support that option. Or I should say that wasn't the staff's preferred option.
The cost.
I think from a student perspective, getting rid of the parking on Dodge shouldn't be a terribly big deal. I like the idea of keeping those two traffic lanes and the one like two-way street. Dodge Street really kind of falls in like on that boundary, like that 30-minute radius of a walk to the Pentecrest, where you could walk there within 30 minutes. So it's kind of on that like nice commuting edge. It'd be good for cycling. And as mentioned earlier, the alley does provide large amounts of off-street parking. If we think of those like kind of stereotypical like 2.5-story split levels from the 70s and 80s, like half of the lots building that have less parking in the back. So I think it won't cause too much heartache if the parking is removed there.
We can quote you on that, right? Mm.
Yes.
So, if I could, I was going to say, too, that I think that's a little bit of staff's part of staff's thinking is that for Dodge Street, if it's not 100% rental, it's 80 or 90% rental. I would say it's probably closer to 100%. And although we're sensitive to students and students' needs, those students, their leases will be up, you know, typically next summer, and they are asked to re-up sometime in January, typically, and re-sign a lease. So we're sensitive to those needs, but certainly Governor Street would feel the effect more than Dodge Street over the years.
Hold on. So with regard to South Dodge Street, what I've been hearing is support for option number two. Eliminate on-street parking and implement a buffered bike lane. That's what I'm hearing. Am I wrong?
Not for me. I'm not comfortable eliminating that on-street parking.
For Dodge?
Not without more specific.
On Dodge Street?
Yeah, not without more specifics.
You want a
one-way
system?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I wanted to finish Governor, but we're not. That was one of the reasons I'd asked Kent about the traffic numbers on Dodge and if one lane could accommodate, because what I would be interested on Dodge is going to one lane, buffered bike lane, keep the parking. Then in my non-traffic background, you come down Dodge Street to Burlington and the right-hand lane is a mandatory right turn. The left lane, if it lines up right. You know, one of them's either mandatory left or mandatory right, and then the other one you can go straight. And then when you get to Bowery, you probably still, because you stop the parking, you could still probably get two lanes there to match up
going through the intersection across Bowery. So to me, it doesn't seem like that'd be too hard a job. So that would be my preference, is to keep the parking on Dodge, go to one lane, and go to a buffered bike lane.
I'm number three on Dodge as well. I think when I look at the other streets on Dodge that are not what we're talking about now, the houses or the apartment buildings don't actually face Dodge. There's very few. And so those streets that don't have on-street parking, that's not an issue. But for that street, it's very different. The houses and the apartments do face the street. Where would these, you know, right now it's 40 cars, where would, we'll say, now 30 cars go when there isn't any parking on Bowery Street, not on Burlington Street. All the other side streets are pretty full already. And so I'm going to go with option. My choice is option number three for Dodge Street.
One thing we haven't talked about, just to throw another wrinkle in there, if time, implementation time is important to you, just know that number three is not going to happen soon. It's going to take some engineering study. I couldn't commit to us doing it next year. I would like to think we could do it next year, but we would have to engage the neighborhood more, and there's some engineering that goes along with that. The benefit with number two, and part of the reason we liked moving forward, is because we could stay on schedule with the implementation. The Dodge Street striping has already been awarded, and while we can carry that over to next year, we could still get it done this year too. So well, if time's important.
I came in thinking I was going to support, if we're speaking about Dodge now, three, but I am, in hearing the conversation and also learning for the first time that the idea of reverting Dodge to two-way, I like the two-way concept because that helps with respect to speeds. You know, the two lanes currently one way, I do think, promote jockeying. But if it goes back to two-way, and I tend to always prefer two-way to one-way, if possible, and I'm not hearing a strong concern about the on-street parking on Dodge.
But do we have, John, do we have two-way for, is it an option, two-way for Dodge?
No, well, that's what staff brought, yeah. Right?
Oh. Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, unless we can't do that, I think that's our intent, is to have Dodge Street go back to two-way, just like we did with Governor years ago.
Oh, okay.
And again, that was the intent years ago. We didn't do it for a number of reasons because there were some other projects going on, but that is our plan, and that was actually part of the, I mean, that is the plan we have now, unless we can't do that.
But if you did it two-way, that means we're still going to have parking and bike lane and all this?
If we go... No. So we can't keep the parking on Dodge if we add a bike lane as it is today. If we go back to two lanes, we would have to reduce it to one travel lane to be able to keep the parking and add a bike lane.
Okay.
With the width as it is today.
That's the street decision.
Width. And I mean, one of the points that Jeff brings up a lot of times on our 4-to-3 conversion, although you wouldn't want to instantly change it back, I mean, if it is a disaster or causes major problems, you can always add the parking, right? I mean, that's something that can happen. So we're not changing the infrastructure. We're just repainting the road, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So I like two, so we can really move on our plan.
I can go as two.
So how many people favor eliminating on-street parking and implementing a buffered bike lane only on Dodge Street, just to get that one out there?
I do two. Two is what I support.
I support two, too.
You support that, right?
I support two.
You support that, too. Mm-hmm. Who else? Anybody else?
Dodge Street?
I'm just talking about Dodge Street.
Yeah, as I said, especially with reverting it to two-way traffic, I'm more supportive of two than I thought I would be. So, yeah, two is acceptable.
You want to say something?
Also, yeah.
Well, I think there's majority support for doing that for Dodge Street. Is staff clear about that notion? We're not going to be able to time. We won't have enough time to finish discussing Governor Street before the formal meeting.
We might.
We can.
About 5 minutes.
It's easy.
Think we can do this in 5 minutes? Okay. Good luck. All right. So we'll find out. Okay. So would somebody propose a solution to the Governor Street dilemma?
I would propose number two.
Number two.
Me too.
Provide pavement markings and signage on Governor Street, meaning Sherrill's.
Yes.
Is that what you mean? Mm-hmm. Is that what you mean?
I'm talking Austin's solution on occupy the lane for two. Yeah. So occupy the lane as opposed to, or bicyclists may use the full lane.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
Well,
the sign.
Well,
is it Sharrow's? Exactly. It's not really Sharrow's.
Well, usually riding on the bike lane.
I would be interested in 5 on Governor Street. I've seen it done in Vancouver, Canada pretty well, but it would maintain that parking for the church. And allow, well, I'm thinking maybe like also on Highland, there's that shoulder that bikes can use, but like cars can park on it as well. But I don't know.
What do you have to say, Kent?
I was going to say we currently aren't using the bikes, may use full lane signs because we've got a few some wrinkles, I guess, with our code that don't allow them now, but they are MUTCD approved, and I think that's something we could work through certainly.
I agree with that, particularly because we also have Summit as an option.
Yeah, it's not as critical.
I think you have a couple of different options. There's also not as much traffic on Governor as there is on Dodge, according to Kent, about half as much, and some of that's northbound and some of it southbound. So you've actually got even less than half when you talk about just in that northbound lane. So while it's not ideal, I agree with you, Jim, it's not ideal for the bicyclists. I think given the critical need for that was expressed by the residents in that area, I think we need to keep the parking on Governor Street.
Okay, the proposal I'm definitely hearing is to, on South Governor, retain parking and provide and two-way, retain the two-way street, but have the northbound part of it. Bicyclists can use the full lane kind of signage.
Yeah, we would use signage something like this, and then we would use, in addition to that, some directional signage, and if we can get through our code issue, the bikes may use full lane signs. It used to be share the road signs, and this is just the new preferred sign. Mm-hmm.
Okay, who supports that idea for South Governor Street?
I'm willing to.
Clear support.
I support it, but I do think we need to test it. I have your concerns about how it will work.
The good news is the traffic volumes are pretty low.
That's right? my point. So it's not like Gilbert, in terms of traffic.
I would be interested, depending on the outcome, I would be willing to look at potentially widening Governor so that we could have a dedicated bike lane there.
Okay, and that'll be something to
be
discussed later.
That's an option potentially later.
Okay, I think we've got a clear decision on that. I would like to say with regard to South Governor, I expect there will be pushback from some residents who park there along the street or else have visitors park there or whatever. I don't know what exactly, but I expect some pushback.
Well,
so,
what?
A governor parking.
We're not taking parking out of
Dodge.
Oh, you just said Governor.
Did I? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. I meant to say South Dodge.
Okay.
I bet.
Thank you.
So I expect pushback with regard to
I would
that
agree.
Not as much as South Governor. Okay, so we need to stop our work session now, and we'll return, convene the formal meeting at 7, and then return to the work session after the formal meeting. So, yet again, it's pretty late.
I was going to say, are any of these issues so important that they can't be deferred until next meeting?
I had one quick thing that I would like to point out now, since we've been talking about the environment and et cetera, was IP15, and I just found it very interesting.
Which week?
I'm sorry, on the September 12th packet, IP15, the minutes of the Airport Commission from their August 15th meeting. I want to commend them for discussing how they can help the city meet its climate action goals. They actually talked about that in their meeting. And I think that's truly an example of how everyone can work together to help us reach our goals. And I especially took note of an interesting idea they proposed of an all-electric plane that could possibly be used for training. I just think they're on top of it there, and they have plans. That's good. So thank them.
The only thing I would mention is we had late handout here from the county about a future land use map and wanting to set a meeting in the next couple of weeks. So I think we need to address that.
Yeah, I'd like to. They have deferred an item. You may recall earlier this year we had a need to create a committee. I think Councilman Thomas, and I don't remember who the other Councilman Teague, you were part of a mediation on a land use issue. This is a similar but not the same. In that case, we were required to come together. In this case, it's more advisory. The county had asked for our opinion on a development outside of our growth boundary. We gave that opinion, and I think the board would like a little bit more discussion prior to making a decision. So they have deferred a vote on a commercial subdivision that is out river south on Riverside Drive, just past our city limits at the intersection with Oakcrest Hill Road. So the county has requested that staff, and if you would like, a couple members of council come together in the next 2 weeks and have an informal discussion with them about the concerns that staff raised with that proposal. So I just ask if one or two council members want to participate, or if the council as a whole wants to participate, that you'd select a couple of members, and then staff would work with those two members to get you up to speed on the issue and then to schedule the meeting with the county.
I'd be happy to participate. It could be that there are others who want to, and maybe I'd defer to that, but
I'm happy to volunteer as well.
They asked for the council members of your choosing, so I'd say no more than three. We typically would do two in a situation like this, but if you prefer to have three, that's okay.
Does anybody else want to participate?
I'd be very interested. I'm going to be out of town a little bit here, and I don't want that to impact things.
They want to meet in the next 2 weeks, so you're probably looking at two meetings, one with staff and one with the county, for the remainder of this week and into next week.
Yeah. I'll stay out of it because I'm going to be doing a little traveling, so unfortunately.
So a couple hours of your time. Probably I'd plan on about three and a half hours total of your time in the next 10 days.
Three or three and a half hours? Is that what you said?
Three, but it's not the meeting 3 hours. You mean like?
No, not a meeting. Okay. But you're going to have a prep. You're going to have memos to read from staff and familiarize yourself with the issue. You're going to meet with staff, and then you're going to meet with the county. So.
Yeah, you can put me as a possible if nobody wants.
Sorry.
I couldn't
hear you.
Yeah.
What'd you say? I couldn't hear you.
I said it could be a possible if somebody else available would be great.
Well, I think John and I have both volunteered. And of course, my window is narrowed by the fact that I'm going to be gone to Dubuque for the 25th and 20th through the 27th. But we can probably work around that.
So all right. Two of you or all three of you?
John is going.
John? Okay. You know, if they, for some reason, schedules don't align, can I reach out
yes.
to you?
Okay.
Okay. I'm not going to follow up on these things, but with regard to the September 12th packet, IPs number 7 and 8, tax exemptions for affordable housing and HCDC feedback, we could probably deal with them pretty quickly, but it's pretty late. And I'm sorry, Tracy, I see you sitting out there. Thank you for hanging around, but... Good grief. And we need to hear about the Emerald Ash Borer as well, but we don't want to do that now.
You want us to carry those three memos over to the next information packet?
Yes.
I think we do. I'm seeing a lot of fading, nodding heads.
I'm really exhausted.
Or just put these two info packets on our next meeting. I don't think they'll take long to go through them, but maybe just do the whole, just put the whole info packets on the next meeting.
Okay.
Thank you.
Then you don't have to move the stuff over to another packet.
Good. Okay. So I think that's it for tonight. So
okay. Great.
We're going to end our work session at that point. Thank you. Great.